Now we close this little cycle and build on the architecture theme by looking at the internal momentum, how to maintain the DiG cycle and building internal momentum to match the external momentum in the marketplace. Let's have a look. Okay, it's about mobilizing the energy within. Clearly, the customer is at the center of momentum strategy, but your people deliver the promise. It's the people that implement it that make things happen. So we want to build an internal momentum. Now, how do you do that? Let's start, first of all, with the most dedicated staff, the committed ones, and the managers. Form a critical mass of, let's say, good people, and then once they start working, getting results, and maybe getting promotions or other acknowledgements, it will spread throughout the organization. Create momentum building corporate reflexes. We'll look at that in a second. Otherwise, you will need to expend resources on continuous reminding, cajoling, planning, rationalizing. It's a bit similar to the external momentum, right? If we've got this momentum approach happening, then there's less need to spend on advertising. A lot of advertising is an ex post behavior. If the product's not good enough, the relationships with your customers, with the staff, are not good enough to generate good, solid growth. Then, of course, as the company grows, you advertise more, but it's more efficient use of achieving growth. Okay, building momentum. So you can use the same execution approach as we did for the product in the marketplace. Apply discovery. What do we mean by discovery? Well, understand what employees really value. So just as we need to understand the deep motivations of customers, look at the deep motivations, the deep interests of your employees, of your staff. So in this case, what would the power offer be? Something that really help, have benefits that help your staff, not necessarily what's out there in the marketplace. Especially if you're a small organization, then the few people you have might have very specific requirements, and if you can offer them to them, then they're more likely to be retained and to be attracted to you. What could vibrant satisfaction look like when you talk about employees? Make employee relations a normal business, not just occasional surveys. So interact, talk to your staff, listen to them, make sure that the listening is effective, so that when they tell you things, you take them on board and take action. Once they start seeing that, then they are more likely to be forthcoming with suggestions, and they're more likely to trust their leaders. Retention. Now, retention is important for staff, and usually when you see high turnover rates, it's a sign of a bad culture and bad leadership. Work hard to retain your good people. They'll best motivate and educate everybody. There's some little joke that I hear people say, well, if we educate them, then they'll leave. If you don't educate them, they'll stay, is the opposite. So as much as possible, have high quality people. And even if they do leave, you have a reputation for being an organization, a company that looks after their people, and therefore you're likely to attract high quality applicants. And then that human resource, that human capital function becomes much easier to manage. And if you retain people, they're also more likely to recommend your company to others because they're happy. They say good things about you, which is not a very common thing. And engagement, what does that look like? Well, people are proud. They're active, positive contributors of ideas and value. This goes back to what I was saying earlier about making employee relations normal. If people see that they're listened to and what they have to offer is considered, it has to be valuable to be implemented, then they are more likely to come forward with ideas and value. What could a momentum culture look like? Well, first of all, let's define culture. A very good one is to say it's the way we do things around here when nobody's watching. That's important. Value statements are often useless. They're important to have, but if they're just something that's written by a consultant or comes down from above, they have no connection to reality and therefore are meaningless. I'm not saying that you shouldn't have them, but if you're going to have them, make them useful, make them meaningful. And the behavior must be natural, instinctive, automatic. So it doesn't have to be an effort to behave in the way that we want to. And this is what we want to see. We want a respectful culture. Motivating, externally oriented. Certainly we want the business and the people to be externally oriented. Naturally curious. Why is that? Well, if you want to discover things that maybe you weren't aware of, you need to be able to look and want to look and enjoy it. Sensitivity is important. Sensitivity to fellow employees, to colleagues, but being sensitive to customers, understanding what drives them, because that's an important part of listening, the sensitivity component. A constructive approach, which brings forward good, useful ideas, future-looking and certainly ambitious. If we are driving a momentum for growth model, then we have to be ambitious. So, absolutely important. We want to please the customer and we want to be the best. That's how we should drive a momentum culture. An interesting example is taking Walmart into Germany, from the US to Germany. It didn't work very well. Often international expansion doesn't work well, and it usually comes down to misunderstanding of cultures or believing that one's originating culture can be transposed just willy-nilly to new environments. There's this famous Walmart cheer they do every day. It did not resonate well with Germans, and certainly employee relations are handled very differently in Germany compared to the United States. They had an ethics code that was struck down from the courts, was not allowed. And certainly consumer culture is different from the USA. Certainly when I've traveled to Germany, the first time I was a bit surprised by how staff, say at a checkout in a supermarket, behaved compared to how they do in Australia. For example, the person who tallied the account and took the money, then stopped, would cross their arms. They didn't help with packing. In Australia, it is common that they should help with packing, or somebody else would do that, and sometimes would even help take the bags to the car. This certainly did not happen when I visited Germany the first time and when I was going into local supermarkets. Environmentalism was much, much more common, more pronounced in Germany than in the United States. You know, for example, with the use of plastic bags, still they remain at the forefront. And so the approach that was taken in the US was not easy to transpose. Another interesting example, in this case, in the positive, was how Johnson & Johnson dealt with the Tylenol crisis. They recalled the product and dealt with it very, very well. Now, this happened in 1982. So in the space of a few days, starting September 29th, 1982, seven people died in the Chicago area after taking cyanide-laced capsules of extra-strength Tylenol, the painkiller that was the drug maker's best-selling product. That really set the reputation for Johnson & Johnson. I think it's been sullied a bit recently, but it was very important. In particular, what happened? They behaved like a decent human being, rather than someone coming out trying to do you over. They were respectful of their clients. They took it back. They had, you know, a negative response financially to how they dealt with this situation. You can go and read more in detail about it. But in the long run, they came back very, very easily. constrained behavior should be avoided. We want to get the best of human nature. Well, constrained behavior really is one where the culture provides unnatural behavior. Managers are put on a defensive armor. The staff put on masks, so we're not open. And there's a barrier to openness, certainly a barrier to humility. And these were things that we said were very important in the beginning for the discovery: open-mindedness and humility. So it ends up being a waste of time and energy. What do we mean by constrained initiative? Basically, your people hold back on great ideas because they do not feel appreciated. It becomes too difficult. It's too much work. Too much energy is required to get good ideas accepted. Again, that turns out to be a waste of opportunities. Whereas in the past, we've just said recently, if your staff, your colleagues can see that their ideas are taken seriously and considered, and if they make sense for the business strategy, then they're enacted, you're likely to get good ideas, and ideas can come from anywhere. And this idea of freedom and belonging, it's the same concept as per customers. If we buy something because we particularly want to, or we go to a business or shop because we want to, not because we're forced to, it's a very different situation. If we do it because we're forced to, then we can very easily be taken away. Same thing can happen with staff and with the culture that's created as a result of these activities. So, if you can, please try. Harness your people. Or if you can, do it to implement this DiG model. So, how to harness the people power. Your actions must be built on resources and a positive corporate culture. Internal momentum. Use the same 8 steps of external momentum and the 2 main drivers, design and execution. Now, the culture is what builds those reflexes, that automatic behavior. It's about customer spirit and the winning external energy. Please the customer and want you to be the best. Useful. Crises can be useful. They are good learning opportunities because they test the reflexes and you can see how the organization responds and how your people respond. Again, constrained behavior and constrained initiative are wasteful. As much as possible, try to bring out authentic, true, and honest interaction, honest communication in the organization. Crucial.